In the last 60 years or so, millions of people across the planet have got the beetle bug. It's been said that the shape of the beetle is one of the most commonly known in the world, and in this special program, we'll meet many of the people who own and enjoy the company of this brilliantly designed machine. Plus, we've got together a whole group of beetle experts to help us bring you the complete story from concept to the latest new water-cooled beetle.
Oh, I think the bug goes down in the annals of motoring history. It's got to, hasn't it? You know, the millions they sold, you know, the number of people who had them. They're going to be in motor museums, and I should think they're going to be in use.
The reason it survives so long is that people do like them. They are different to your average car, you know. I think most blokes like them because girls like them.
It was an easy to maintain car, didn't cost a lot to run, was friendly to the environment because it didn't use as much fuel as the big V8 cars in America.
I think the Beetle is a real classic because it just puts a smile on the face of its owners. It smiles back at you when you look at it, and it's really great fun to drive and own.
When they were new, if you didn't mess with them, they were really reliable, and they didn't mind what sort of weather it was or how bad the fuel was that you put in them. They just kept going and going and going, and there are Beetles that have done a million miles.
The Beetle could go anywhere. It could live in the on the Arctic Circle, and it could drive around in the deserts of Saudi Arabia. It could cope with all those conditions.
You think that's a Volkswagen you're looking at? Well, it is, and it isn't. It's a Volkswagen we put together ourselves, from parts.
To demonstrate how simple the construction of the original Beetle is, have a look at this TV commercial, where the guy sitting inside the car literally take it all apart and clear the set with it, all in one shot. Incredible.
So in case you've been wondering about how many parts we carry, you can stop wondering. We carry all you need.
In the States, this self-deprecating humour that Volkswagen is taking, making fun of itself, was something other people have also tried to copy, but perhaps not quite as successfully as in the early days of Volkswagen. I remember there's one where you have a basketball player who's about 6'10" tall standing next to a Beetle, and the first shot says they said it couldn't be done. Then you see him sitting in the car with his knees up round his ears, very uncomfortable, and they said it couldn't. And the unexpected line, the humour, the underclaiming, if you like, was something that endeared the Volkswagen brand to the American public.
Try looking at a Volkswagen this way. It's the only small car with a sealed steel bottom that leaves nothing exposed beneath it. And the VW is built to take a little punishment.
The big success was the States. And we heard about it via the States because it suddenly hit the States in the 50s, and it was the complete antithesis of the big 1950s American car that was all chrome and huge and fins and, you know, triple headlights and great chrome teeth and, you know, and the little Beetle.
Volkswagen announces air conditioning.
And who would have thought the Beetle would work? And it did in California. It really took off.
The VW is so well put together, it's practically airtight.
Fantastic adverts, television advertising and press advertising. And that came back over here, and we started sitting up and taking notice in the mid-50s.
Doyle, Dane and Burnback adverts, such as Think Small, Live Below Your Means, Lemon was another great advert. These were all so different than anything that had come before them.
Quite a few Volkswagen ads featured scenarios where you weren't quite sure what it was advertising till the very end. This happens a lot in modern advertising.
Some of the early movie theatre ads were wonderful. All it showed was just a huge snowdrift.
Here we realise that this guy in the Beetle gets through the terrible snowdrifts okay to get to work. His job?
Seine Arbeit ist einen Schneepflug fahren.
A snowplow driver.
Have you ever wondered how the snowplow driver got to work?
The Beetle was always meant to be a no-frills mode of transport, and this is demonstrated in this TV commercial. Here's a James Bond lookalike in a Spanish Volkswagen advert who is rather frustrated by his all-singing, all-dancing Bondmobile when nothing really goes right. So in the end, he saves the world in his Beetle. To learn how the Beetle started life, we'll have to travel back to the 1920s.
The problem with Germany in the 1920s was, of course, that they'd just lost the First World War rather comprehensively. And the treaties and agreements that were signed at the conclusion of hostilities actually forbade German motor manufacturers from seriously getting back into the business of manufacturing. I think BMW, the mighty BMW, were actually reduced to making pots and pans.
Germany had lost the First World War, was having to pay huge compensation to the Allies. Germany was in political chaos, financial chaos, industrial chaos. Nobody had a car, except the very rich.
It was very fragmented into small companies. For example, NSU, which joined the VW Empire, started off producing knitting machines and bicycles.
It was very hard for the German motor manufacturer to actually come up with a mass-produced car.
So cars continued to be a status symbol in Germany until in 1932 the Austrian inventor and designer Ferdinand Porsche came up with this prototype for the NSU company.
The engine was in the back because basically in those days the technology with front-wheel drive, the steering wheels and the drive was a little difficult. Some were doing it, notably DKW. He realised that the weight of the engine had to be over the driving wheels, of course, as most cars are today. But he realised that the technological advances of those days did not allow a reliable, honest front-wheel drive. That took another 20 years, and the name of Alec Izaguirre springs up, of course.
What you had here with the Beetle, which was an aerodynamic shape and an engine that was air-cooled with a gearbox at the front of the motor, that's what was radical and revolutionary about Porsche's designs.
The engine in the original car was a flat four, as it always remained, four cylinders lying on their sides, horizontally opposed, what's called a boxer engine, air-cooled with a fan standing upright and blowing air over the cylinders, also an oil cooler, which played a more important part in the cooling than most people realise. And that engine sat in the forks of a very strong frame carrying a flat floor pan on which the body could be mounted, so an extremely rugged type of car.
Porsche wanted a two-stroke. Hitler, in fact, wanted a three-cylinder diesel, but Porsche wasn't so keen on diesels, and diesels in the 1930s were pretty primitive, heavy, old-fashioned, for lorries.
Yeah, very, very clever ideas in those days to have torsion bar springing, you know, air-cooled engine in the back, simplicity, ease of maintenance. Of course, they say ease of maintenance. You talk to anybody who's had to replace a Volkswagen crankshaft and they'll tell you it's not quite as easy as they would have you believe.
Once he was happy with the basic principles, Ferdinand Porsche submitted his idea for a mass-produced people's car, or in German, Volkswagen, to the government of the Reich.
In my research, I've been pretty well conclusive that Porsche had the design of the Beetle in his pocket before he was invited to Berlin to talk to Hitler. Hitler wanted the Volkswagen to sell to the masses for 1,000 marks, and Porsche had the design more or less in his pocket. The Germans had been looking across the Atlantic since the 1920s, 1930s, saying, hey, you guys, everyone over there is driving a Ford T. Why can't we have a Volkswagen or a Volksauto? And then Hitler came along and said, if you vote for me, I'll give you jobs, I'll give you cars, I'll give you autobahns.
Perhaps typical of all politicians, and you know, we can include Hitler in this, the popularity of the government depended on what it gave the people and what it gave them at a good value.
Hitler couldn't actually drive himself, but he had met Porsche back in the 1920s on the racetrack with some of Porsche's early designs for a Mercedes, and he was a fanatic. He loved cars, but he couldn't actually drive himself.
He wanted the German people to be able to get around the country, hence the autobahns. In fact, the autobahns were in place before the Volkswagen.
Quite simple, isn't it? It does what it says on the tin, so to speak. The Volkswagen, the people's car.
It was designed as a people's car. It was run as a car that ordinary working people who normally would not be able to aspire to a car of their own could, in fact, own.
The reason that Hitler wanted one is to buy votes. You know, even today, our government and Her Majesty's opposition will come up with initiatives or claims that they can make life easier for the motorists. But Hitler's claim was that he would turn every German family into motorists. And that's a pretty powerful propaganda tool. And he actually put in place a savings plan that would enable every German family to own their own car.
5 marks a week, which was quite difficult for the working man in those days, but it was possible. And in 4 to 5 years, he had enough stamps to buy his Beetle.
The only trouble was that he decided he was going to wage war on the rest of Europe a few months after the savings plan came into action.
Unfortunately, none of them got the car.
I think people actually did. I think some people actually got their cars. They sort of, after the war, they went, excuse me, I've got my book with like the payments in and stuff like that.
After testing here at Porsche's private estate in 1936, it was agreed that the new car was ready for production, named the KDF Wagen.
Porsche was horrified at hearing that his car, his baby, was not going to be the Volkswagen, but the KDF Wagen. KDF, Kraft durch Freude, the strength through joy car. Porsche was horrified.
I think Porsche did mind the association with the Nazi Party, but I suspect that there wasn't a lot he could do about it. He was going to be quite nicely paid by Hitler and his party for producing the car, and he went along with it. After all, it enabled him to set up a company producing very nice sports cars after that.
In 1938, the foundation stone for the Volkswagen factory was laid at Fallersleben near Hanover, and soon Dr. Porsche's revolutionary machine was being mass-produced by the thousands of workers there. It's Germany in the late 1930s, and everybody is wowed by the new people's car, which soon gets the nickname of Käfer, the German for Beetle.
Just like the Mini, it wasn't originally known as the Volkswagen Beetle. It was just the Volkswagen, the people's car. Where the nickname comes from is one of those things that there is some debate about. Some people say it was the Germans who came up with it, the German public, but the Americans reckon that it was only when it arrived in the States that its Beetle-like appearance led to its anthropomorphic nickname, the Beetle.
John Colborne Barber, who lived near Canterbury, he was the first person to introduce the Beetle really to the British market. And he realised he had a wonderful car here, and he started the Volkswagen Owners Club in 1953, 50 years ago, and he called it the Beetle, and his first magazine, of course, was Beetling.
The name stuck, but only as a nickname. It wasn't officially used by VW on a car until they bought out a car in this country called the GT Beetle in the early 70s, and that one was badged GT Beetle. Up until then, it was just Volkswagen Type 1.
Motoring experts the world over were won over by the amazing specification of the KDF car.
Yes, when I first joined Volkswagen, my colleague said you should contact the journalist Gordon Wilkins. He's now 90, living in the south of France, but he attended the original launch of the Beetle in 1938 in the presence of Adolf Hitler. And I think he's the last surviving journalist to have attended that presentation.
With a rapid 0 to 60 kilometres an hour time of 14 seconds and a top speed of 100 kilometres an hour, that's about 62 miles an hour, outstanding road holding and a 4-speed gearbox, this was an astonishing package for a cost of only 990 Reichsmarks, the cost, remember, of an average motorcycle at the time.
The road holding was interesting. Of course, it was a swing axle rear end. So, and a lot of weight that was out beyond that rear axle line. So the laws of Newton took over on a wet road, and the usual thing to catch you out was on going into a curve, and it was a little bit tighter than you thought it should be. So you backed off and turned in a bit tighter. And then it was just like a yo-yo. The back end went woof, and you couldn't catch it no matter how quickly you wound the lock on. In fact, people who drove Beetles in those days used to say that the best thing on a roundabout when it started to go was to steer away from the skid, not into it, so that you would go around quicker and then sort it out without bouncing off curbs or hedges or brick walls or whatever. not a technique that the driving schools recommend.
Well, the Volkswagen, of course, was also a phenomenon in as much as it was the first car ever to have exhaustive testing. They tested the Volkswagen prototype before the war for well over 2 million kilometres. It had never happened before. But with the machine, the political machine over there, they just called soldiers and they said, drive this car until it breaks.
The other thing that is lesser known, Beetles were known for their sort of unburstable quality, which was that you couldn't over-rev them. And the fan did consume a lot of power. And the power a fan consumes goes up with the cube of the speed. So in other words, if you run the engine twice as fast, the fan consumes 2 × 2 × 2, which is 8 times as much power. Now, with a Beetle, if you try to over-rev the engine, the fan acts like a governor on a clock mechanism. So in other words, if you faster you go, the more power the fan consumes. So it automatically protects the engine from over-revving, but in doing so it's highly inefficient, so Beetles were very thirsty for that and other reasons when run at high speed.
With the war starting, the factory now had to be used for far more important purposes than simply personal motoring.
At the beginning of the Second World War, the Volkswagen factory was more or less finished, but they hadn't got any machines in there to produce anything. And so they stopped it. And so Porsche said, well, let's get this factory finished and we can build something else in it. So during the war, of course, the factory was not only to produce the military versions of the Volkswagen, the Kubelwagen and the Schwimmwagen, they also built a lot of other parts. They built iron stoves to heat the German soldiers up on the Russian front. They built wings for aircraft. The Junkers 88 was built with a lot of the parts for that car was built in Volkswagen factory. After the war, of course, it was completely destroyed. The Americans didn't know quite what they were destroying because it wasn't on the maps of which the Americans had, which were all drawn up in 1936-37, and the Volkswagen factory was built in middle end of 38-39, and so when they got this huge factory, they didn't know what it was, but they bombed it anyway.
After the war, anything with four wheels and an engine was taken over by the Allies to transport essential goods. The Volkswagen factory was about to be completely flattened until Major Ivan Hurst of the British Army spared the demolition after realizing the financial capital the plant and the revolutionary Beetle car could raise.
If it hadn't been for Major Ivan Hurst and the Royal Engineers who saved the factory, it really wouldn't be around.
I think to understand why a British Army Major, Major Hurst, actually ended up saving the Volkswagen factory after the war, presumably under the instructions of his seniors, the British government, the British military, was to try and avoid that situation, the Weimar Republic in 1930s Germany, where Hitler and other extremists were able to claim that the Allies had bankrupted Germany, had reduced Germany to the status of like a kowtowed nation.
He swears that all he was doing was his job. He was told by Remy to report to the factory and see if it could be restarted to produce badly needed transport. And he moved heaven and earth, he and his team, to do just that.
The fact that the VW factory was saved was just part of the idea that instead of the situation after the First World War, after the Second World War, Germany should be helped to rebuild itself.
He went over to Wolfsburg and he saw the mess, he saw the hungry people and he saw a factory and he thought, well, we could make cars here. He was an extremely lovely man, a humanitarian guy. He was an idealist.
When I first joined the company, I'd heard of the legendary figure, Major Ivan Hurst, who it was told saved Volkswagen. And when I got a contact number for him from a journalist, I thought, well, I'll give him a ring. He can only tell me to clear off, or he might want to talk. And that first conversation, Ivan was on the phone for about 20, 25 minutes, and I found a very intelligent man, still interested in cars, a passionate engineer.
He basically rebuilt the factory and got it all going again and started production.
Ivan Hurst, who I met a number of times, was a very altruistic guy, and he swears that all he was doing was his job.
The first car that I remember him riding in with me was a Corrado 16-valve before the G60 came out. He used to take me to this Bacon Butty caravan up on Saddleworth Moor, and we parked the Corrado there, and two young guys drove by in a Golf GTI, turned round, stopped, went up to Ivan and said, oh, can we have a look under the bonnet? And Ivan opened the bonnet, lifted it and was talking about the 16-valve engine, because at that time he himself had a Golf GTI. And they never knew who he was. They drove away not even knowing that if it wasn't for this man, they almost certainly wouldn't have been driving around in their Golf GTI.
Major Hurst's brief was to get the Beetle factory going, then to try and get a buyer, but nobody was interested, not even Henry Ford.
The reason why Henry Ford wasn't interested in buying the factory, although Porsche had visited Ford and found out all about his mass production techniques and utilised them, I think they even bought presses from Ford to make the Beetle. But the reason he wasn't interested was simple. It was too close to Russia. The factory was too close to Russia, and he was scared that they'd take it off him.
I think Ford and Roots as well, who also turned it down, I think the reason was they thought that the car wasn't up to much, and in fact they both said so. Henry Ford's famously quoted as saying, "What we've got here is not worth a damn."
From Ivan's point of view, he didn't really want the factory to fall into American hands, and he actually told me that they did various things to show the blackest side of the factory. And he regarded it as a success that Ford didn't want to acquire the plant.
The company Roots had also rejected the car, 44, 45. They'd looked at it quite close. The Humber Motor Company rejected it. Almost 20 years later, Hillman, part of the Roots company, introduced the Hillman Imp, which was, I think, the only production rear-engined car ever made in England.
Over the years, word spread around the remarkable Beetle car, and production went from strength to strength. With the plant now on its feet and renamed Wolfsburg, the British Army handed the factory and the company, now called Volkswagen GmbH, back to the federal government of Germany.
It's a cruel irony, isn't it? You know, and now you've got Volkswagen owning Bentley and BMW owning Rolls-Royce and BMW bringing out the Mini. And you know, 1945, their industry was in complete ruins. And the Royal Engineers fought very hard. I mean, don't underestimate that. They had a lot of things against them. And they fought very hard to keep that factory going and provide staff cars for a few army officers of Volkswagen Beetles. And look what developed into.
The top was made out of great metal. Everything, early Japanese cars, for instance, when you come to strip them these days, nothing was put together with grease. On these, everything seemed, they just took that bit more attention to putting them together. Like this one, for instance, you're over 30 years old of a car and it's still running today. It does need a few repairs, but it's still there. It's still got all its major components. Coming to this age, it's corrosion more than anything. The engines will stand the test of time, the suspension, your gearbox, but the bodies are just starting to fail now, which is quite a good testament to the steel that was used originally.
As far as design faults in the early cars are concerned, the headlinings were glued in with fish glue. So when it got warm, they stank of fish, which is probably not nice, especially if, like me, you don't eat fish.
Annoying things, well, the visibility was awful. The noise level was very bad. Had no petrol gauge. You had to stop and shove a wooden stick in the fuel tank to see how much petrol you've got. Terribly convenient that was. You had to pull a switch to bring in the reserve, you know. Things like that, the deliberately minimalistic approach did get on your nerves after a while.
This film is of a visit by the Federal Chancellor as the factory produces the 500,000th Beetle. The Wolfsburg plant was now the largest car factory in Europe. Plus, the car was selling well around the world, not just America, where the Beetle started exporting in the 1950s, but Holland, the UK, Libya, Norway, Australia, Austria. It seemed everybody wanted to drive their own Volkswagen Bug.
Well, the Beetle took off in the 1960s. It was really the perfect transport, wasn't it, for the hippie chicks, the flower power generation. Here was a motor car that was acceptable even to the sort of sandal-wearing, bead-bedecked tree-huggers of that era.
I mean, in the 1960s, I think everybody from all walks of life were driving Beetles because of their reliability and because they got you from A to B in some small style.
The Beetle itself has had a, a unique combination of both immense levels of practicality, durability, reliability, and just this huge sense of fun that pervades through both the hard top and the soft top versions of the product. And that's been consistent right through time, and you've seen movie makers make the most of that with the Herbie films, and I think it still puts a smile on the face of customers today.
By 1955, the million mark was reached, and the empire had grown to creating subsidiary companies like this one in Brazil, where the largest car plant in South America was built.
The Beetle was always pretty labor-intensive to build, which is why Volkswagen really desperately wanted a replacement back in the late 60s, early 70s. They were not making very much money on it. Although it all bolts together and it looks very easy to build, it has a lot of complicated parts in it. The engine gearbox assembly is constructed of expensive light alloy.
You didn't have to be a particularly technologically advanced workforce to bang a Beetle together. And so when Volkswagen realised that they could make them in South America for rather less than they could expect to make them in Germany, bearing in mind what they'd pay a South American workforce, then they made lots of them there. And in fact, they actually exported South American-made Beetles back to the German market.
The cheap labour, which was an essential part of keeping Beetle production going in Mexico and Brazil as well, was available there. And so you'll find that shots of the production lines in South America look rather different from those with all the robots that we're so used to seeing now in Europe.
Part of the benefit of this low-tech design was that you could use a low-tech factory and, without causing offence, a low-tech workforce to actually put themselves together. It was done with all vehicles like this, with a Mini, with scooters. They were made all over the place. If you could find a cheap workforce.
Indeed, the old Beetle and this new Beetle have been going side by side on production lines in Mexico for several years now.
In the 1960s, the Volkswagen Beetle really began to generate a character all of its own, and this personality was reflected in the irreverent and cheeky advertising of the Times.
In the beginning, Volkswagen built the Beetle, the original small car.
Of course, a Volkswagen could easily overtake a sports car, or pull a couple of huge trailers. The testing of the cars was pretty unconventional as well, certainly in the adverts. If the car still worked after the famous somersault test, it would be pretty impressive.
Owning a VW today, a VW Beetle today, again, it's basically not like any other vehicle on the road. The owners are friends, they're your friends. People who own Beetles tend to be interested in their car.
The best place to find a load of Beetle lovers together is at one of the many regular Volkswagen events. This one is at Tatton Park in Cheshire.
Well, I grew up with Volkswagens. My parents always drove Volkswagens, and I got my first Beetle when I was 16 to learn to drive in. Restored it, ready for when I was 17. Passed my test, and I've never been without a Volkswagen. Phenomenal technology went into it, considering, you know, the shape of cars that were previously being built, and it was groundbreaking as far as aerodynamics are concerned, as far as getting as much air into the back where the air-cooled engine is, and as making to make the car as user-friendly and family-friendly as possible, which was the whole concept of the people's car. They're a fantastic car to own. That's why so many people have them for over such long periods of time. It's why a lot of people buy new Beetles, because they can keep their old Beetle for the weekend and drive something that's a little bit more practical and a little bit more comfortable. They are a little bit different. They take some getting used to, but they're not a difficult. All round vision's really good, and they're easy to maintain if you're a young kid who's not got a lot of money. So great first car. As far as cheap to run, you can't get cheaper with historic insurance. No tax to pay, it's free road tax, easy to maintain. I don't think there is a cheaper alternative, really. I mean, I drive a modern car every day, and as soon as I get into the Beetle, I close the door and I just relax. And I know I'm not going to drive fast, there's no pressures, I don't have to worry about overtaking people. I take, you know, every mile in my own stride, and it's a great de-stressing process for me.
It's a car, it's got soul. Modern stuff doesn't. You know, that's the whole point. Yeah, he got the design right. I mean, how many car designs lasted as long as these did? the Beetles. They're marvellous. This old thing was stuck in a back street, not far from where I live. The kids had jumped all over it, bricked the windows, generally wrecked it. I went one night, felt sorry for it, and spent 3.5 weeks every night welding, more welding, additional welding. Painted the poor old thing for a present for my wife's birthday. It kind of gets to you owning a Volkswagen. You can't let them die. You feel sorry for an old V-dub. You've got to save them. It's cruelty if you don't. Beetles have character. Modern cars have nothing. They're boring. They really are. You drive it, you get in, it goes, it comes back. You get in this, every trip's an adventure. Are you going to get there? That's the whole point of it. It's fun. Why drive something boring and modern? Drive something with a bit of character.
It's just a fun car. It just, every time I get in it, every time I drive it, everywhere we go, it just gives me a lot of pleasure. It makes me smile. My car is a blue 1970. His name's Billy, which all VWs have names. It's a 1970 with the early panels, the sloping lights. It's been slightly lowered. It's a 1600cc, and it has a slightly different interior.
If you haven't got a classic Beetle and you'd like an imported new one, it's still not too late, even though production recently stopped.
What's happening at the moment is, of course, production's recently finished, but of course, there are cars already in Mexico, more cars on the way on boats across from South America, and therefore, we, Beetle Driver, Northern Agents of Beetles UK, long established as importers, they've been importing these cars for like 6-7 years, we are still able to get cars. Part of the beauty and character of a vehicle like this is that it is, to a great extent, bolted together. It's very easy to repair. Not everything's welded, lots of nuts and bolts, but that does make it a labour-intensive vehicle to produce. And therefore, you're going to have what one might regard as outdated practices in a factory because of the labour-intensive nature of a vehicle. But that is what makes it its character and its long-lasting nature of a vehicle, you see. All vehicles in South America are, of course, produced in left-hand drive form. The production volume is not sufficient for the factory to manufacture vehicles on request in right-hand drive form. So they're all brought over in left-hand drive form, starting as low as 7,995 pounds in left-hand drive form. Some customers are quite happy to leave them in left-hand drive form because it's the character of the vehicle, and they don't want, you know, they don't want any changes making. Other people select from our options list conversion when they come into the UK into right-hand drive.
Now here's a rare Beetle, but it's sort of shrunk in the Cheshire rain.
First saw one of these in Harrods 30 odd years ago, and I believe that the price was £3,500 in Harrods in those days. This then came to light over 20 years ago. I saw it in the Volkswagen agency in Crewe, where we come from. It's a half-size model. It's 3 foot wide, 3 foot one to the top of the screen, and 7 foot long. And it's just half size if you look at the real vehicle. And it's powered by a Briggs & Stratton type lawnmower engine. Electric start, lights work, horn works, everything to do with it. I think when you look at the Volkswagen Beetle, it's a collector's model, like the Morris 1000 and all the classic cars. And as you see by the show today, a lot of interest in the Volkswagen Beetle. And I think that's why they made such a thing.
At a show like this, the new Beetles rub bumpers with the classic.
It's mainly what the Beetle would be like today if they'd kept on changing it like they would do with the Golf and things like that. I think the main thing is that it's continued on the character of the old car. A lot of people might say that, you know, the engine should be in the back, it should be air-cooled, but if you look around here today, the amount of new Beetles that are here, the people have still got the same enthusiasm for them as the old ones. The cars have a lot of character, and I find that basically most new people who like the new Beetles also like the old ones as well. I first got into them when I was 17. I bought my first one for £950 and started doing a lot of work on it myself.
and I quite enjoyed that, and I've just continued doing that myself.
Here's a bug converted to a drag racer. According to the owner of this beauty, it's not quite a mad idea as it sounds.
They're actually quite an obvious car to use. They're so underpowered as standard, it's very, very easy to make them go quicker. The engine being in the back gives them perfect weight distribution for racing, and it just makes them a very, very easy car to get started in. Plus, having our own one-make championship really does help. We get a lot of support from VW traders. When I started going to Volkswagen shows in 1995, I'd seen the racing and thought, oh, that's pretty cool, I want to have a go at that. And it wasn't until 99 when I actually got a car that was capable of doing it. So I started racing my everyday road car, and then after a season or so, I thought, I'd best start racing properly and build something like this. When you actually win a series of races, you get a trophy and quite often a cash prize as well. Cash is always dependent on how many people you've actually had to go through and beat. But usually, for a reasonable field, you get between £70 and £100, which is nice. And then that's a big high, the actual adrenaline buzz of winning. Big lows, it's expensive, or can be, and things do break. There's always the risk of crashing, but my big low point this year is blowing three engines up in four race meetings. That's my big, big low point. But my big high point is winning Bug Jam, which is the biggest Volkswagen drag racing event of the season. My advice for anybody who wants to come Volkswagen drag racing is do it. If you have any Volkswagen, water-cooled or air-cooled, all you need is a crash helmet and a fire suit and a Motorsport Association licence. Join the Volkswagen Drag Racing Club and that's it, you're in, and you can race and you can win. Anybody can do it, it's as easy as that.
This is a Beetle. Well, part of it is. It's an award-winning creation from Stoke-on-Trent's John Rathbone, who gave up the life of a welder to set up his own specialist workshop, and the order books are full.
They're a bit different than most cars. The mechanics are slightly different. But I got interested in them in 1987. I went to the first Volkswagen show. There's a few areas that you need to know what to look out for, but to remove a lot of the components, you could strip a whole car down in a day, basically. And it's very, very easy to work on. And a lot of young people have them as the first car to learn mechanics with. I think the Volkswagen Beetle, the style of the body, it's so unique because it's never been copied, and it retains its character. Mostly we specialise in high-performance Volkswagens for road or track use. We do a lot of metalwork fabrication to the bodywork, and we build performance engines and gearboxes and chassis. This particular car is based on a 1970 Volkswagen Beetle. The only part of the car that's original is the roof. The rest of the bodywork is Kevlar. It's a full tubeless base frame chassis with a 2,500cc turbocharged engine running on methanol. There's an unbelievable amount of hard work involved in running and building cars like this. You've got to be really dedicated, and it takes a lot of commitment and a lot of hours and also a lot of money. Volkswagen drag racing in this country has been going since 1987. Basically, drag racing is two cars over a quarter mile track. It's basically the first one to the finish. I've done a quarter mile, 10.16, 146 mile an hour is my quickest time. It does 60 mile an hour in just over 1 second.
On the 19th of January 1978, the last Beetle came off the line in Germany, although of course it was still being built in South America. Just the German car count was jaw-dropping. The final production line count there was 16,255,500. Together with all the factories around the world, we're talking over 21 million Beetles. No other single car shape in the history of mankind has been built in such large numbers, or arguably been advertised with such flair. At the Detroit Motor Show in 1997, a rather special concept was unveiled that was based on the underpinnings of a Golf. It was simply called Concept One. But as people got closer, they recognized some certain curves. Didn't it look like a Beetle?
After the Beetle, discontinued sales in the States, Volkswagen's presence there declined. And the question was asked by the then chairman, Dr. Piëch, what would we have to build to restore Volkswagen to the American market? And he asked this question of the Volkswagen design studios in California. And what we now know as the Beetle, it was then Concept One, was, if you like, the concept to prove that.
The new Beetle has been a great opportunity to build on the years of tradition that we had with the original Beetle and make a car that lives up to all those traditional values. It's immensely practical, immensely durable, and huge amounts of fun in a modern design.
One of the interesting things about the new Beetle, of course, is the love-hate relationship with old Beetle owners. At the end of the run of the Volkswagen Beetle in Mexico on the 30th of July, CNN had a survey in America on the website, and people were invited to answer, do you like the new Beetle or the old Beetle? The alternative was, they're both ugly. And the old Beetle had 36%, the new Beetle had 25%, and 39% thought they were both ugly.
They released it in America in 98 first, and it was going to be a couple of years before we got them in the UK, and I decided I just had to have one. So literally the day they went on sale in the States, I had one shipped over, and this is the actual first example to reach these shores, you know. It was great. The only trouble was every time I filled up for gas, I couldn't get going because people kept coming up. And the thing I did notice is people want to touch it. A very tactile car. I remember Brit coming home from a show, the first show I took it to, and there was nose prints all over the glass.
Brian Burrows is a real Beetle enthusiast. Not only has he bought his daughter a version of the classic, but he has some astonishing examples of the classic Beetle in his garage.
I've been into the cars for, 17, 18 years now. And I've done a bit of everything. I've won trophies for sort of radical custom sort of show cars. I've drag raced them. I still drag race a Karmann gear now. I hold a world record for a funny car that was built, which a funny car is a glass fibre body over a chrome moly chassis. And that ran the quarter mile in 7.7 seconds. And it's still a world record even 10 years later. The orange car is actually tomato red is the official colour, although it's orange, it's blood orange. It's one of the last German Beetles to be made. And it belonged to a dealership in Northern Ireland. It stayed there for years and years, and it only ever had trailer mileage on it. And I was lucky enough to get hold of it, and it's got 60 miles on the clock. And it's as close to a brand new German car as you can get, because of course they don't make them in Germany anymore, and they no longer make them in Mexico either. The 49 is a standard 49. It's one of the earliest sort of examples in the UK. When Major Ivan Hirst got the factory re-going after the war in Wolfsburg, they didn't start exporting them until 49. So it's obviously, as you can see, it's a very, very early car. And again, it's been just beautifully looked after, beautifully restored. And there's just something pure and untouched about the very, very early cars, you know.
Now, the term classic car is possibly the most abused in the whole of the motoring lexicon. There are about half a dozen true classic cars, cars that were revolutionary, radical designs that provided a solution to a big, big problem and that were absolutely spot on right from the start. I'm talking about the Mini, the E-Type Jaguar, the Willys Jeep, the Citroën 2CV and the Volkswagen Beetle. Ferdinand Porsche was a genius. This is the fruit of his genius, and the reason it lasted so long is because it was so right from the start.
In 1948, when Porsche came out of prison, he and his son got together, mainly the son, and they developed a sports car. It had a different chassis and a different body, but it was very clearly mechanically, electrically, engine, etc., etc., Volkswagen. Indeed, when the first 356 Porsche owners were restoring their cars, they were amazed to find Kubelwagen parts in the engine, on the suspension, in the electrics. Don't forget, without Porsche, Professor Porsche, there would never have been a Beetle, and without the Beetle, there would never have been a Porsche.
The Beetle shape closely approximates to the shape of an egg, which is an intuitive shape. It embodies strength and life, and it's friendly, and it's a shape we're familiar with, we like.
The reason the Beetle's lasted so long, nearly 70 years, is because it was designed by a genius. The design was good, the car was good, the parts supply was good and still is good, and it's unique. It's the best car ever. Simple as that.